In today's topic, we are going to discuss about metabolism of bilirubin and how it is produced from different systems. Let us see. If we take average 70 kg man, approximately 200 billion RBC die every day, which in turn produces 6 grams of hemoglobin per day. 1 gram of hemoglobin produces 35 milligrams of bilirubin. Then 6 grams of hemoglobin produces 210 milligrams of bilirubin. If you see the normal production of bilirubin, that is 250 to 350 milligrams per day. From where does this extra bilirubin is produced? If you see here, the extra bilirubin is produced from bone marrow and other heme proteins. From bone marrow through inefficiency of erythropoiesis, and other heme proteins which produce bilirubin are myoglobin and cytochrome C. Now, let us see how bilirubin is secreted. In our circulation, if you see, we have RBCs whose lifespan is 120 days. Once the lifespan of 120 days is completed, it enters into spleen. By splenic macrophages, these RBCs gets destroyed and lysis has been done. Once the lysis of RBC has done, it releases metabolites like metabolic substances like lipids, proteins and hemoglobin. These lipids further break down into fatty acids and get reused, and proteins further metabolized into amino acids and gets reused, and hemoglobin further break down into heme and globular chain. This globular chain further metabolizes into amino acids and gets reused. Now the leftover part and which secretes bilirubin is heme. If you see heme here, it breaks down into iron and bilirubin. Iron gets reused and the leftover part is bilirubin. If you see here, heme directly don't produce bilirubin. Heme, in the presence of heme oxygenase, first gets converted into bilirubin in the presence of heme oxygenase enzyme. Now this bilirubin converts into bilirubin in the presence of bilirubin reductase. Now our final product bilirubin is secreted. This bilirubin is very toxic substance, so it should be dealt properly. The secreted bilirubin all the way enters into circulation, and the bilirubin which enters into circulation is unconjugated bilirubin. This unconjugated bilirubin is very small molecule and it has tendency to escape into microcirculation and other tissues. So how we should avoid this and how we should trap this unconjugated bilirubin? From liver, some special plasma proteins are released into circulation. All the way it travels in the circulation and binds with this unconjugated bilirubin. Now this complex is plasma protein binded unconjugated bilirubin. Once it gets binded, this unconjugated bilirubin is a large complex. Now it can't easily diffuse back into microcirculation or get filtered. As we all know that plasma proteins are plasma protein binded substances, can't get filtered easily. Now, once the binding has been done, all the way through portal circulation, it enters into sinusoidal capillaries. On the surface of sinusoidal phase, we have special receptors which intake this unconjugated bilirubin. Remember here one important point, that only bilirubin is uptake here, not plasma proteins. The plasma proteins will be left over and it will be circulated back. Now, the uptake of bilirubin has been done here into hepatic cells. In hepatic cells, the cytoplasmic proteins binds with this bilirubin so that it won't escape back into circulation. What are those cytoplasmic proteins? Ligandin and substance Y. Once binding has been done with these cytoplasmic proteins, then if you see in our hepatic cells, we have a special organelle called endoplasmic reticulum. These endoplasmic reticulum have special enzyme, that is glucuronyl transferase. With the help of this glucuronyl transferase enzyme, this bilirubin binds with 2-UDP glucuronic acid, and that it converts into conjugated bilirubin. Now it is conjugated bilirubin. This conjugated bilirubin, now it should be transferred or transported into biliary system. How it will be done? Let's see. The conjugated bilirubin, if you see on the canalicular side, we have special transporters. On the canalicular side, we have special transporters for the transportation of this conjugated bilirubin. And here you should remember one important point. This is the rate limiting step, and this is the active transport, where it uses energy for the transportation of conjugated bilirubin. Okay? And the protein which involved in this transportation is MRP2. So, this is the rate limiting step. Through this transport, the conjugated bilirubin now enters into biliary system. Once it enters into biliary system, along with bile, all the way it enters into GIT through ampulla of Wetter. Once it enters into GIT, it travels from small intestine into large intestine. In large intestine, with the help of special microbes and enzymes, this conjugated bilirubin converts into urobilinogen. This urobilinogen is now our bilirubin. Now, let us see what happened here. Once the urobilinogen is formed, if you see here, we have a special portal system through which blood is collected from GIT, all the way it travels through liver and enters into sinusoidal capillaries. Through this portal system, some part of urobilinogen, that is 2 to 20%, will be escaped and travel into sinusoidal capillaries. From sinusoidal capillaries, it enters into circulation. This is urobilinogen. Now, this urobilinogen will be filtered and excreted through urine So bilirubin is, some part of bilirubin is excreted through urine and it gives yellow color to urine. Yellow color. Now only some part, that is 2 to 20%, in that only 10% is excreted, and again in this 2 to 20%, which is reabsorbed through portal system into sinusoidal capillaries, 10% will be recycled and only 10% is excreted through urine. Now major part is left over in this large intestine. This urobilinogen in large intestine further converts into stercobilinogen. This stercobilinogen gets excreted through feces, and this stercobilinogen gives yellow color to feces. This is how bilirubin is secreted, excreted and dealt in the liver and excreted with different systems. As we already discussed metabolism of bilirubin and its excretion. Now let's see clinical application of bilirubin metabolism. As we already discussed earlier, that the bilirubin is produced mainly during the breakdown of RBC and other heme proteins. As bilirubin is highly toxic substance, it needs to be detoxified and excreted. Failure of this leads to hyperbilirubinemia and jaundice, which means both are not the same, because hyperbilirubinemia may be asymptomatic or symptomatic. Let's see, the normal level of bilirubin in the serum is 0.2 to 1.2 milligrams per day. If bilirubin level goes above this normal level, then it is known as hyperbilirubinemia. But hyperbilirubinemia may or may not develop jaundice, because approximately greater than 2.5 to 3 milligrams of DL of bilirubin may be symptomatic of jaundice, and the symptoms will be in the form of yellow discoloration of skin, mucous membrane and sclera. Due to hyperbilirubinemia, that is greater than 2.5 milligrams per DL, then it is defined as jaundice. Then what is meant by scleral ectyrus? If there is hyperbilirubinemia and sclera turns yellow, then it is scleral ictyrus. Then what is kernicterus? If unconjugated bilirubin goes heavy amount into the CNS, then it is called kernicterus, which is mainly seen in newborns. Next, what is physiological jaundice of newborn? What? Physiologic jaundice of newborn. Normal physiologic jaundice of the newborn typically appears between 2nd to 5th day of life, as well as in preterm birth, because of underdeveloped conjugation system, and it clears with time without any treatment. Now, what is pathological jaundice? It is considered if it is present within the first 24 hours after birth. The total serum bilirubin level rises by more than 5 milligrams per DL as per day, or it is higher than 17 mg per DL, or an infant has signs and symptoms suggestive of serious illness, is considered pathological. This is something important information about bilirubin. Thank you.